Hello everyone, I hope you are doing well. First thing first, today's video is the 98th in my lecture series, which I started a few months after the pandemic began last year. I started the video series with the intention of utilizing a globally catastrophic situation to the benefit of everyone in the community in terms of theoretical knowledge and practice. I'm very happy and fortunate to have made many connections with practitioners from around the world in the last year and a half. I'm also very happy to see the exchange of information and experiences with members of the community, which has only made this video series better and the community stronger. And since today's video is the 98th, the 100th video is not too far away. I plan to make the 100th video a little different from all the prior videos. In all my lecture videos so far, I have hardly said anything about my personal life except maybe a few examples about my own practice experiences with my grandfather and first teacher Yang Qinglin and my Tai Chi teacher Ma Hong. But in the 100th video, I'm planning to share my personal experiences with the martial art and Xiudao community, both within China and outside of China. Well, I have already planned some details I would like to share with you. I would also like to answer questions from the community related to my personal experiences. But let me be clear. When I say personal experiences, those would only be limited to martial art, Xiudao, Qigong, and possible other related topics. Please don't ask me about my amazing foreign language skill or who the best chef in Montreal. For the record, I'm the best chef in Montreal. So please let me know your questions in the comments or email me if you prefer to remain anonymous. It has been a while since the last video in the Decoding Martial Proverbs series. So let's change that today. Recently, some of my students and the community members asked me about the proverb 走不离累. Since they noticed somebody questioned one of my Xingyi auxiliary exercise video posted about 2 years ago, and they also hinted at some personal attacks being made. Also, thanks to Eric Potter for asking me about the same in the comment section of the last Q&A video. First of all, I do not perceive it as a personal attack at all, since I do not have any conflict with said person. Basically, my video is titled 5 Elements Single-Hand Force Training Demonstration. Link is in the description. Please have a look if you haven't already. That is the very short video clip, which demonstrates a small single-hand exercise used to practice Fa Jin. In the video description section, I wrote, quote, "Practicing 5 elements with one hand is a useful and practical method toward cultivation of Fa Jin or force generation. This is not meant for beginners. It is an enhancement, not a replacement, for the standard 5 elements practice." However, apparently, a few people have misinterpreted this video as violating the principle of 走不离累. I had also answered a question relevant to 走不离累 in a prior Q&A video. Link is in the description. I originally thought 走不离累 was so well known that any further explanation wasn't necessary. But based on recent feedback I have received, it's become evident that the answer I provided wasn't sufficient to fully clarify 肘部离泪 and many people are neither totally in the dark or have a flawed understanding of 肘部离泪 which is also the reason they misrepresent the single-hand five-element practice. So, that's the motivation behind today's video topic, 肘部离泪. Topic covered in today's video include, first, shortcomings of in Chinese martial art proverbs. Second, background of 肘部离泪. Third, practical application of 肘部离泪. Fourth, principles of 肘部离泪. Fifth, my refactored version of 肘部离泪. Sixth, demonstration. Seventh, correction of student practice. And eighth, takeaways. So, without any further ado, let's get started. Topic 1. Shortcomings in Chinese martial art proverbs. A major issue of Chinese martial art proverbs is that they are just stated as a matter of fact without further clarification or explanation of nuances involved. And oftentimes, even without any clear definition to begin with. I have stated this in many prior videos, but I'm stating this here again for anyone who is new to this channel. When you read a proverb, it may seem that you understand it. However, application of the proverb in practice is a whole different story. Or even worse, many proverbs often do not make any sense to begin with, especially to a beginner. If you just read the proverb literally, then most likely your understanding would be wrong. Also, most of the proverbs do not provide any information about when to use it, how to use it, and why to have it, and so on. So, you need an expert to explain it to you, or you will definitely make some unnecessary mistakes in applying them in practice. With all that in mind, if someone were to take the proverb literally for what it is and not evaluate it against the basic aspect I mentioned just now, that would be yet another unfortunate example of cultural utopianism, which I have already criticized in the past. In a prior video, I introduced a solution to fully understand the meaning and implications of a proverb or concept. Let me state that solution again. First, always find out the first occurrence of the proverb in history. Second, analyze the context in which the proverb was used. Third, refer to different documents or different versions of a single document which mentioned the proverb. Fourth, compare and contrast your understanding of the proverb so far with different experts. Fifth, repeat the previous four steps if necessary for further strengthening of your understanding. This procedure should enable you to explain any martial proverb. This procedure is what I would follow and have followed. I can't stress enough the importance of this methodology in any research related to martial art or anything to do with history and culture. If the intention behind your work is to improve existing knowledge and understanding of practice such that future generations will find it even easier to take the practice forward, an honest and serious approach is an absolutely must. Anything short of this approach would either be lazy or dishonest, and you will only end up doing a disservice to the practice as well as to the community, both present and future. I hope this gave you out a good idea behind my research methodology and efforts. I'm well aware that this approach often makes my content sound dry and boring, and my dad jokes don't make the situation any better. So, if entertainment, controversy, or rumor mongering are your topics of interest, there are plenty of other channels you can seek out. So, let's move on to the next topic for a deeper dive into 肘部离类. Topic 2, background of 肘部离类. 肘部离类has been a very popular martial art proverb, especially in the last 3 decades. First, let me literally translate it. 肘 means elbow, 不 means without or do not, 离 means leave or away from, and 肋 means rib or ribcage. Put together, the very literal translation becomes, the elbow will not leave the ribcage. Like I mentioned earlier in the introduction of this video, I have briefly explained this term in a prior Q&A video. To save some breath, let me replay that part of the video now. Thank you for the video. In one of your videos, you said the knee extend outward. Does this apply to the elbows as well? Also, I was watching a video of a Xingyi guy in China saying the elbows don't leave the flanks. Can be clarified this please, if possible. I would really appreciate it. Thanks. Thank you for the question, Blazing 50. Well, the idea of elbows never leaving the flanks is a very common misperception caused by translation. It is just impossible to never let the elbows leave the flanks. Actually, in Chinese language, 肘部离类, which translates to elbow do not leave the ribcage, can mean many things. For example, elbows have to be close to the ribcage so that the ribcage area can be protected. During formal practice, when the elbows get close to the ribcage, you will be naturally forced to move the body more. So, no matter what, 肘部离类 does not mean that elbows should not leave the flanks. In the Chinese language, very often, many words are removed from a term to make it sound phonetically pleasant. So, the flanks should actually be written as the entire space in the vicinity of the ribcage, not just the physical ribcage. Blessing 50, I hope I have answered your question. Given the very nature of Q&A videos, I only provided information of 肘部离类 that I thought was sufficient back then, which included clarification of the key concept. That's why I'd like to fix that today. Like I just mentioned a few minutes ago, 肘部离类 has been very popular for a few decades now. Also, this proverb is not only used in the internal martial art community, but also many other Chinese martial art styles, including Shaolin, Baji, and so on. Since I don't practice Shaolin, Baji, and other styles, I'm not qualified to talk about them, although I know excellent practitioners of those styles. So, I will limit further explanation only to the internal styles. So, before we go any further, we first need to answer the question, is 肘部离类 the entire proverb? No, it's not. A slight longer and better version of that proverb is 肘部离类，手不离心. Mind you, this is still not the entire proverb. I will get to the entire proverb later in this section. But for now, let me translate the second part of the above sentence. 手 means hand. 不 and 离 mean the same as in the first part of the proverb. Xin means heart. Put together, the longer version of this proverb can be translated to elbow does not leave the rib cage and hand does not leave the heart in translation. To the best of my knowledge, in the context of internal styles, 肘部离肋 was first mentioned in 心意拳拳谱 or 心意拳 training manual. Not 心意 with a G, but 心意 without a G. This document contains many important theories of 心意. I have this document that I hand copied back when I was in high school, since copy machines were very difficult to access back in the 1980s in China. This is my hand copy version of the document. Well, it is difficult to ascertain who the original of 心意拳谱 was. Most people agree upon the author being either 姬继可, the founder of 心意拳, or his student 曹继武, approximately 340 years ago. 戴龙邦, the founder of the Dai family 心意, wrote a prologue of this book in 1750, a little over 270 years ago. So, this document should definitely be older than 270 years. 李洛能, the founder of the 行意拳 with a G, was a student of the Dai family. So, 心意拳谱 or 心意拳 training manual contains the proverb 两肘不离肋, 两手不离心. Literal translation: two elbows will not leave the rib cage, two hands will not leave heart. End translation. Now, does the translation make realistic sense? Definitely not. Now, you may be tempted to say that Hai Yang is against those ancient martial concepts, since many Xing Yi masters in history also talked about 肘部离肋 in their books. Well, please do not jump to conclusions and make stuff up about me. I not only respect ancient theories, but I have also done my best to promote them by translating, interpreting, and elaborating them to the community for over 30 years now. What I'm actually saying here is that we have to better understand those proverbs instead of merely accepting them at face value. What I disagree with is the literal translation and the limited interpretation of 肘部离肋, not the proverb 肘部离肋 itself. So, what is the meaning of 肘部离肋? Well, as I mentioned earlier, in order to understand a proverb written in an old document, we first need to find out its original context in that document. Now, let me read the whole sentences in my hand-copied version of 心意拳谱. By the way, many documents in the martial art community often have different editions due to the mistakes caused during the hand-copy process. However, this part is consistent in all the versions of this book, no matter who the hand-copier is or was. So, the whole sentence is, quote, 两肘不离肋, 两手不离心, 出动入动紧随身, 乘其不备而攻之, 焉其不易而击之. Translation: two elbows do not leave the rib cage, two hands do not leave the heart. Elbows and hands moving inward and outward will follow the body. So, attack when the opponent is unprepared and strike the opponent by surprise. End translation. Now you can see that the proverb, two elbows do not leave the rib cage, two hands do not leave the heart, is in fact meant to describe a defensive posture in which your rib cage and the chest area are protected by the elbows and hands. It is just the typical protective posture, a standard guarding posture, since the second part of the sentence is talking about striking the opponent at the right opportunity. In other words, maintaining a protective posture by holding the hand and elbows at the right place. Hands are in front of the chest, while elbows at the rib cage area. The five sentences together build up the complete proverb. While the first two or three sentences are more widely known, the proverb remains incomplete unless all five sentences are included. In classical Chinese language or Wen Yan Wen, very often people put the part that they want to express at the end of the sentence group by using neither extension of meaning or tautological method, or opposite of meaning or antithetical method. There are classical linguistic structures largely ignored by new generations or uneducated people in the older generations. In that case, the second part of the sentence group, which is the striking and attacking part, is the concept that the writer intended to express, which is the opposite of meaning or antithetical method used in language structure. I have been studying the classical Chinese language of Wen Yan Wen since I was a child. I can use the classical style to write Chinese articles, poetry, and other forms of literature. Combining that with my Xing Yi practice experience enables me to interpret Xing Yi and other martial art classics without any difficulty. And it is understandable that many people easily make mistakes in interpreting them since they lack the necessary cultural understanding and context. For the rest of the video, I will use Zhou Bu Li Lei to mean the entire proverb consisting of five sentences. Also, worth noting, there is no mention of the application of Zhou Bu Li Lei only within the context of five-element practice or any form of style, neither in Xing Yi Quan Pu or any other traditional Xing Yi training documents. Again, we have to analyze the proverb by putting it back to the original context of the document and interpreting the meaning correctly, or mistakes and misinterpretation will definitely occur. Again, I can't emphasize enough the importance of applying the right methodology. To summarize, Zhou Bu Li Lei, Shou Bu Li Xin describes a guarding posture. It does not imply that an elbow sticks to the rib cage and the fist stay on the chest, or simply the elbow sinks downward and the hand stays on the chest. It is just a simple proverb, yet it confuses many people and can lead them to faulty conclusions, unless they actually refer to the contextual information in the original document. Topic 3. Practical application of Zhou Bu Li Lei. Now that the original context behind Zhou Bu Li Lei in the document Xin Yi Quan Quan Pu has been clarified, practitioners should understand that Zhou Bu Li Lei expresses a comparatively static and defensive posture in a dynamic or combat situation. The protective posture created by the hands and elbows is rather static compared to the dynamic nature of striking action. However, practitioners need to maintain a dynamic mental state in observing an opportunity to strike the opponent. So, Zhou Bu Li Lei, Shou Bu Li Xin, or two elbows do not leave the rib cage, two hands do not leave the heart, actually expresses a dynamic mental state with a rather static physical state. Being able to differentiate the static and the dynamic is important in dealing with the posture itself and its changes like further strikes to the opponent. By the way, 肘部离肋 is a proverb nowadays used mostly by the 形意 community since 形意 with a G developed directly from 心意 without a G. Most proverbs used in 形意 can be directly applied in 形意 with or without minor changes. In 形意, we always use the full proverb, usually so that people will understand it without unnecessary misunderstanding. If you assume 肘部离肋 to be a self-contained or stand-alone proverb, you are just plain wrong. Misunderstandings are natural if you assume a part of the whole. Moral of the story, any proverb should be quoted fully, not partially. Even better to understand the context surrounding that proverb. It is worth pointing out that the application of 肘部离肋 isn't limited only to 形意. It is also used by other styles such as Tai Chi, Bagua, Shaolin, and many others to express the same meaning or new meanings attributed by practitioners of those styles. After understanding 肘部离肋 and 手部离心, now I'd like to elaborate the drawn term 肘部离肋, 手部离心 further. Does 肘部离肋 imply the elbows never leave the rib cage or that the elbows have to stick to the rib cage? Well, there's another term for it called 肘部贴肋, which is another important principle of practice. Accompanying 肘部贴肋 or elbow does not stick on rib cage, there's another proverb very often cited in the community, 腋下含空. 腋 means armpit, 下 means under, 含 means contents, 空 means space. Put together, it means there is a space under the armpits. So, the 腋下含空 or a space under the armpits is the cause of 肘部贴肋. Zhang Zhaodong's branch of 形意 emphasizes 肘部贴肋 a lot, and most of the Tai Chi schools also take 肘部贴肋 as an important requirement for correct body structure. By the way, some styles such as Chen style Tai Chi taught by Hong Junsheng emphasize the elbow sticks to the ribcage momentarily in some movements, which is the unique approach of that style with some specific reasons according to their standard. Therefore, we have to know that even literally speaking, 肘部离肋 or its counterpart 肘部贴肋 can be applied to different situations according to the style and the practice. Specific proverbs should be analyzed specifically according to their context, practice, and specific situations for martial applications. Using a specific proverb universally for any situation will only lead you astray. Now, I'd like to talk about another popular martial proverb, 沉肩坠肘 or 垂肩坠肘. Both proverbs express the same meaning and are interchangeable and equally popular. 沉肩坠肘 can be translated to the elbow and the shoulder sink. So, 沉肩坠肘 has nothing to do with 肘部离肋. Even though they look like they express the same meaning, but in reality, they do not at all. Now, the key question here is, how to think correctly and sufficiently? Well, you have to make sure that your elbow always point to the ground. Is that even possible all the time? Well, no and no. Actually, 沉肩坠肘 means the energy sinks while simultaneously maintain a solid and strong structure created by the elbows and shoulders. The key aspect of body energy is to be able to extend in 8 directions, not only sink downward. So, please be very careful when trying to apply this kind of a proverb into your practice, or you will overemphasize one aspect at the expense of other more important aspects. Now, how about some important principles of 肘部离肋? Well, that brings us to the next topic. Topic 4, principles of 肘部离肋. Since 肘部离肋, 手部离心 is used to describe a guarding posture, I'd like to talk about two important principles of this term. First, 行松易紧. Translation, body relaxes and mind is on alert.I have talked about 行松易紧 in one of my prior videos titled Stance, Internal Style Concept No. 7. Link is in the description. In that video, 行松易紧 applies to the 肘部离肋 practice as well. When holding the guarding posture, the body should be relaxed and the entire body should possess the intention of expansion,While the mind is on alert. 行松 or relaxed body can ensure the body can move fast. The mind is on alert is to observe any opportunity in combat. Second, 拔面支撑. Translation, the body should have energy in different 8 directions while maintaining the 肘部离肋 posture.The reason is very simple. You may need to move forward, backward, sideways, upward, or downward. There's no guarantee that you will always move forward. So, the body needs to be able to direct energy in different directions so that the body can react faster in both defending against and attacking the opponent. When holding a guarding posture,It is simply incorrect to have the body only maintain a downward energy because it will make you much slower in responding to the opponent's attack. In practice, practitioners should focus on the intention of expansion in different directions in both static and dynamic states. These were just two of the many important principles governing 肘部离肋. I will introduce more of them in the future. Topic 5. My refactored version of 肘部离肋. Evidently, the original 5-sentence proverb is much harder for most people to remember in its entirety.Causing a lot of misinterpretations and misrepresentations, thus regarding people's practice. That's why I think it's important to refactor the original proverb to be much shorter while still preserving the intended meaning of the original proverb. So, I have coined a new proverb to replace the original 5-sentence proverb.The refactored proverb is 手肘互伸，相击而动。手 means hand, 肘 means elbow, 互 means protect, 伸 means body. 相 means identify, observe, 击 means opportunity, 而 means to, 动 means act, strike or attack. Put together, it means protect the body,With hands and elbows, identify an opportunity to strike. The original proverb has 5 sentences with a total of 31 words, while the refactored proverb has two sentences with a total of only 8 words. Again, the meaning of the refactored proverb speaks for itself, and I think there's no need for any further explanation. But please do let me know if there are any questions still left unanswered, either about the original proverb or my refactored version. Topic 6, demonstration. Today, I'd like to demonstrate Xing Yi practice from Zhang Zhaodong's branch. Zhang Zhaodong was a prominent Xing Yi master of Tianjin. He created the famous Xing Yi Bagua Palm. I have a video titled Introduction to Xing Yi Bagua Palm, Bagua with a Xing Yi Influence in my channel. Please have a look if you haven't already. In that video, I introduced Zhang Zhaodong and his Xing Yi Bagua Palm. My grandfather Yang Qinglin learned from him directly, so I have a lot of information about him and his style. His Xing Yi has the obvious expanding motion, not only in movements but also in stance. Okay. Then, one movement. Topic 7. Correction of a student's practice. Now, I will correct my student's Cheng style single changing palm, a standard practice of any Bagua style. Stay here. Okay, let my student demonstrate the Cheng style first palm, which is single changing palm. Then I correct his movement. Okay, please come to the center slowly. Okay, first of all, when the palm moves downward, Bagua palm is different from Xing Yi like this. Bagua like this, finger point more forward. One, yes. At the same time, sink down the body. When the palms move downward, body sinks downward. Then next movement. Okay, be careful here. After this movement, make sure the little finger, this area extends forward. Do not turn the palms so early. Then start to drill. Right, slowly, slowly. Then make sure right hand slightly sink down. Yes, then. Yes. One, two, three, then four. Now let's come back. We correct the movement. Yes, you can start from just from here, from this movement. First of all, here downward a little bit. Second, put a less strength. Third, turn a little bit. Yes. Then when you walk, one, stop at here. Okay. This angle should be less. Second, make sure thumb straight. Then this one point upward, here forward. Then this area push down. So one, right? Nice movement. Two, the left foot should make circular movement. One, you see? Two, okay? One, right, two. Two, focus at this area, two, okay? Have a holding motion. And the elbow extend a little bit more towards rib cage. Do not too close. Two, next movement, three. When you make the three, here keep extending, three. Three, yes, continue, then four. Then this palm first, slowly, too fast. So one, two, then gradually. Then sink down the shoulder, sink down the elbow, then keep walking. Then eventually close. Yes, then relax. Thank you. Topic 8, takeaways. A lot of proverbs have been introduced in this video. Well, at first glance, they may seem overwhelming and confusing, especially if you are new to Chinese language. Actually, they are not. Give it sufficient time and practiced, and I'm positive that these proverbs will make perfect sense to you. So, let's quickly recap the things covered today. First, shortcomings in Chinese martial proverbs. Most Chinese martial art proverbs are just stated as a matter of fact without further clarification or explanation of nuances involved, and oftentimes even without any clear definition to begin with. Second, background of Zhou Bu Li Lei. In the context of internal styles, Zhou Bu Li Lei was first mentioned in the document Xin Yi Quan Quan Pu. The complete proverb actually consists of five sentences. 两肘不离肋，两手不离心，出动入动紧随身，诚惜无备而攻之，焉其不义而击之。 3. Practical application of 肘不离肋。肘不离肋 expresses a guarding posture using the hands and the elbows to protect the body, while simultaneously being on alert for favorable opportunities to strike the opponent. 4. Principles of 肘不离肋. First, 行松易紧, translation, body relaxes and the mind is on alert. A relaxed body should help you move fast, while an alert mind observes for opportunities to strike the opponent. Second, 八面支撑, translation, the body should have energy in different 8 directions while maintaining the 肘不离肋 posture. When holding a guarding posture, you should focus on the intention of expansion in different directions in both static and dynamic states. 5. My refactored version of 肘不离肋. Most people would find it difficult to remember the complete original 5 sentences 肘不离肋 proverb. I have coined a new proverb, 手肘互伸，相击而动, which should be a lot easier to remember, yet will express the same meaning as the original 5 sentence proverb. 6. Don't forget to check out the demonstration and the student correction section to get a better idea of correctly applying 肘不离肋 in your practice. That brings us to the end of today's video. A quick reminder to send me your questions about my personal experience with martial art and related practice, and also my experiences with the martial art community both within and outside of China. Thank you for watching. See you next time and enjoy your practice.